when that bomb went off, it's like, oh my gosh, they're playing with stuff that's way more advanced than they even know what they're dealing with. And if this were to destroy the planet, because that's the road it was on, if they go down this road and it destroys the planet, it sends out shock waves, not only for our planet, but through, I mean, in our galaxy, but through the universes. I mean, it's like multiple layers of universes and timelines, everything. It just really wreaks havoc. And they're like, we can't have that. That is not okay.
Well, I sat down again with Julia Cannon, the daughter of Dolores Cannon. We had another fantastic discussion, this time about the book, The Three Waves of Volunteers and the New Earth. We delve deep into the three waves, the concepts discussed in the book. I think you're going to find this discussion fascinating. So the main premise of the book obviously centers around this idea that this call needed to go out after the atomic bomb was dropped during World War II.
Yes, absolutely. That when that happened, that sent a shock wave out through the universe, and it was like this, these, you know, what mom was always saying is like, these kids are up to stuff. I mean, like, we can't let that happen. You know, there's a law of non-interference that nobody can do it. They can't come in. This is part of the rule of the planet, part of the rule of everything is non-interference. We have free will. We can do what we want. We were given this game board. We were given, you know, free will to run it and everything, unless we were about to destroy ourselves. And then something can happen. And at that point, because they said they could not allow something like this to happen. You know, when that bomb went off, it's like, oh my gosh, they're playing with stuff that's way more advanced than they even know what they're dealing with. And if this were to destroy the planet, because that's the road it was on, if they go down this road and it destroys the planet, it sends out shock waves, not only for our planet, but through, I mean, in our galaxy, but through the universes. I mean, it's like multiple layers of universes and timelines, everything. It just really wreaks havoc. And they're like, we can't have that. That is not okay. So that would be the point that they being other beings, other, you know, they can come in and do something. They can step in if we are about to destroy ourselves. That's their rule. So, and that's when they saw that when that happened, it's like, oh no. They need help. They are going down this road that is not good. And so the call went out to universes, multiple, you know, just throughout the galaxies, throughout everywhere, you know, the parts that we were like, does their life, is there life? Is there, you know, it went out to everywhere and said, hey, Gaia needs help. Mother Earth needs help. These people are about to destroy it. They need help. We need to raise the vibration of the beings that are on this planet. You know, the planet's going to do her thing. She's doing her things, but if we destroy it, we can't, you know, what can she do? And that's not allowed. You know, we can't do that. So that's where, okay, the beings on the planet are the ones that need help. We need to raise their vibrations. How can we do that? We cannot step in and say, hey, guys, cut it out, stop it. But we can go in and influence. And that's where that call was. It was like, let's go in and influence by raising the vibrations of these beings. You know, one, the actual beings on the planet, there will be a certain percentage of them that are already a higher level vibration. And then by that being there, that will affect the others. It will show them, give them examples of how to be, you know. So that's where, when these beings come in, they broadcast an energy that radiates through everybody, and we all improve by it. We all raise from it. So that was the call that went out. It's like, can you come and help these poor lost people, these beings that are there, you know, don't understand what they're doing, what they're playing with. You know, they need to go on a different road.
Yeah.
They
And
have
where
to do
that's
that.
where the concept of obviously, let's look at some of the waves. The first wave, and because a lot of people ask the question, well, where do I fit? Am I first wave? Am I second wave? and my third wave. And we've got a kind of a rough guide for that, because generally the first wave were born between the late 1940s and the early 1960s.
Right. The first wave came right after the bombing, you know, so it was like they came in immediately, you know, as soon as it was, the call went out. So you could look at that first wave. It falls in line pretty closely to the baby boomer generation.
Yeah. Yeah.
Really close. And I was thinking about that. It's like, that's really interesting, because they talk about that baby boomer. It was like, it's a big, huge influx of people. Hello. It's like volunteers, you know, we put a call, they all came in. So
yeah,
it makes sense.
And these ones actually had, didn't they, the most difficult time adjusting to life on Earth, because often, you know, they were the first ones that were here, and they really had this strong sense of feeling really alienated and really longing to be home, and that this wasn't home.
Well, I think every wave has that feeling, but that first wave, because they were here, it was like, it was, if you were to be dropped in on a deserted island or a really rough terrain or something, and you've got to civilize it kind of thing. It was that kind of a setting, even though there were people here. But if you can imagine the energy, the, you know, it was in fear, heavy fear of being, you know, people are attacking us and we got to defend ourselves and we got to have bigger bombs. And, you know, that kind of an emotional environment was here. And, you know, everybody's so, it was major fear. And so that's what these beautiful souls were coming into. And these souls that volunteered were from very high frequencies or directly from source, or, you know, so they're not used to killing and any of this fear stuff. So it was like, oh my gosh, what am I doing here? And that's where they, you know, they probably had the hardest time, that first wave, because they're the ones that are paving the way. They were the ones digging the trenches and making the first paths through. And so it was tougher for them.
Yeah. Yeah. And it was a heavy vibration at the time, given we had just had a world war. You know, people were immigrating to different countries because Europe was largely destroyed from the war. And so there was a lot of chaos during that time, a lot of upheaval, a lot of change. So it would have been very hard. And I remember your mother saying, actually, a lot of those people felt like they wanted to commit suicide. They wanted out because they couldn't really handle it.
Absolutely. They didn't understand, you know, because even though you're coming, you volunteer and you come in, one of the major rules for planet Earth for coming in here is you forget. You forget who you are. You forget why you're here. You forget everything. You forget your connection to source. You forget all that beautiful, all the beautiful agreements you made before you ever came in. That's just part of the rules. Even though they're volunteers, they agreed to abide by the rules of the planet. Okay. And it's like, okay, forgetting everything. And then they're like, what the heck? I don't understand this place. I want to go home. I don't know what home is, but I want to go home because this ain't it. I'm like, what the heck? You know, what, who, and who, these people around me, who are they? They don't identify with their families, maybe, and things like that. Like, I don't know what's going on. And see, that's coming from that part that is still, that's connected, and it knows things, but remember, it forgot. So, you know, that's where it can be very tumultuous. And yes, many, many probably actually did commit suicide, but many more even, you know, wanted to and tried. And if it didn't work, it was because they were here for a reason. And this is a big deal, as I'm still delivering that message. You came here for a reason. Stay, get it done, then you can go.
Then you can go.
Then you can go. Just finish what you came here to do. You volunteered for this.
Yeah. It's a good reminder. I get asked a lot this question, whether your mother was a first wave volunteer.
Yeah, she would say no, because she was like, oh no, I'm before that. But, you know, because of what she did, either she was, or she had a great contract with all of this as far as to allow it. So it can be whatever, but she was in there plowing the way. So it could very well have been.
Yeah.
She would tell you, no, I was way before that. So
yeah.
Yeah.
So that's why those timelines, they don't really fit, because sometimes there's a lot of people ahead, some second wavers came in during the first wave phase, maybe, it's like they were some that
were
ahead.
There's a crossover, and it's almost like a rough guide, isn't it? Because the second wave were born between the late 60s and then the early 80s. So
the second wave, see, that's where we're trying to, early 80s, yeah. Maybe even a little bit. Or yeah, that's
even
right.
Beyond, that's right. You know, it's a rough guide, even beyond that.
Well, see, this thing has shifted. It's moved, and we never put years on it. She was always like, well, they'd be about this old now. And when she was doing her lectures and so, and I never actually put like what years that was in there. So so that's probably pretty close.
Like it's a rough,
I know the second waves are in their, like they're in their 40s, 30s, 40s now. And 50, so that would probably be right. Because when he was lecturing on all this, it was like the new ones were just coming in. We'll see, now they're all in their 20s.
Exactly. So it's we've moved into the third, and the second wave were I think described as the generators of positive energy, and the antennas as well, the influencers. They struggled less than the first wave, but it still was a struggle for them and is ongoingly.
It's still a struggle. I mean, it was a struggle because it's still a foreign place, but because the first wave came in and was plowing the ground, it made it more hospitable. There was something, they didn't have all the harshness that first wave had. They have a little bit more acceptance, a little bit more. It's like you could see this thing shifting. The biggest thing, like I said, the antenna, they are antenna bringing the energy in. That's the sole purpose of the volunteers, is bringing this other energy in to influence the earth, influence the people. Okay, so that's why the first wave did it by plowing the way. They were coming in and they were doing it, but it was different for them. The antennas, I'll just call them the antennas. The second wave were just, they bring it in. And what's so cool is, I mean, I've gotten now where I can just pretty much recognize the second wave just like that. I mean, they are really easy to identify. They're usually doing something just like you're doing, Paul.
Yes. Well, funny, I was born in 1981, so kind of fit in there.
Yeah, they're usually doing something in broadcast, something where they can send things out. It's really interesting how whatever they're doing is something to do with putting out to the masses.
Yeah.
Broadcast antenna, bringing energy in and putting it out. I mean, what better?
Yeah. Well, and look at the world during this time, the 80s, the 90s, we saw this huge shift in media, didn't we, with television, and then it went satellite, and then the internet came along, and now, other advanced technologies have all sort of happened from that generation between sort of 80s people, 90s kids as well. Just a huge shift into media, in this huge media landscape that we accept now, and it's just constantly evolving. And what I love about the third wave that your mother spoke about in this book is that they are like the children that are born with all of this new DNA, right?
Right, because the whole thing, as these waves are coming in, they are showing us, it's like that's bringing the new energy, and it's also connecting our DNA. It's getting we're having all these things connected, and then that's where we're being shown this is the new being kind of thing. The third wave comes in with the DNA all connected, all the new strands, they're not new strands, they were strands that were just laying there dormant, so now they're all connected. And they come in with them all connected. And what they are here for is basically to show us what we can do. It's our potential. So that's where you'll see many of them doing things that it's like, how do they do this? They just boom. They know everything. They already know what to do. It's because they are showing us. They're the examples for us to, this is what you can do. This is your potential.
Yeah. Well, and you see that with kids, don't you, these days? I know people always comment about, you know, maybe their grandchildren. They say they just pick up this technology so quickly. It comes so naturally to them. Or they just, that they have these minds that where they comprehend so much. So we actually see a lot of that, don't we? When we look at younger people.
Absolutely. And that's where, you know, there was another thing that third wave especially did is they are being born to waves. You know, where at first it was like, the first wave was like, I don't want to be stuck here. I'm going to do my thing and I'm going to get out. I mean, they really, really had a hard time. And so they didn't want to do anything that might hold them to this place. And having children was something that might do that. So they were like, nope, don't want any children. I don't want nothing that will hold me here. And so then the second wave was coming in and those were starting, they were kind of, if the first wave had any children, it was probably a wave. It was probably the second wave. But anyway, the second wave, like I said, but they had a little easier. So the second wave was like, they had a different attitude. So some of them, they were like, they were afraid at first. And I remember in many lectures, they were coming in, it's like, I'm afraid to have children because what, you know, your mother says it's going to create karma and it's going to stick me here and blah, blah, blah. And I was like, and what I received was, that's up to you. Remember, if you have a wave, it'll be totally different. And that's what I was getting is the waves are starting to have waves.
Yes.
That's a completely different. And who better to understand a wave than a wave? And that's what we see happening. You see these parents that understand the new children. They understand and they give them the space that they need to grow and do what they, you know, what they naturally can do. And then by that, then that's influencing again the rest of us.
Yeah. Yeah. And I suppose the ultimate goal of all of this is to raise the vibration of the planet to help human evolution raise to a point where we're not creating wars, we're not destroying the natural world around us, that we have a new consciousness. It's becoming more and more evident that we're becoming a lot more conscious. You know, I mean, even discussions in media over the last 10 or 15 years around just being aware of the planet more. These were conversations that weren't being had 20 years ago.
Exactly. It was such a foreign thing. Oh my gosh, it never would have happened before. But it's happening now more and more, you know, people shift. You can really, and that's what I call the shifting. You know, we say, whoa, when's the shift going to happen? It happens every single minute. You'll see another little thing. And that's how it happens. It's very gradual. And you have to look back. You have to go back like 20 years or whatever, and then look forward and say, okay, has anything changed? That change is the shift.
Yeah. A shift into this new earth. And, you know, I'll ask you this. My interpretation of the new earth was not so much a physical place, but rather a state of being or a higher dimension that we move into. Is that kind of your take as
well?
That's
my take. Yeah, Mom, she kept trying to understand it and she tried to get as much information as she could. And she kept coming up with it's a physical place. And so some people still adhere to that. There's a physical earth being prepared out there and everything. But that's not my take. My take is everything's energy. It's all energetic. It's all frequency.
Yes.
This earth, it's here. I mean, they told me in 2011, it's already happened. It's done. You will see it when you believe it. And it's all a matter of when your energy, you have to raise your frequency to that point. And they showed me, and I'll do it this way because I don't know why this way, but it's like, if this is the old earth and this is the new earth, and they showed me the different vibrations on each, this was real dense and a lot of drama and all that stuff. And this one's very light and airy and just beautiful, peaceful, all that stuff. And then you have all these in between, you know, all these parts in between. And it's like, we're scattered all in there and we're making choices every minute, every day as to what we want to do. Okay. So it's like, and based on choices that we make, it moves us closer to this vibration or it moves us closer to this vibration. That's simply it. It's no right, no wrong. It's just vibrations. And you can tell by when you make a decision or you make a choice, you can tell how it feels. Does it feel, then you know that's going this way. If it feels, you know, drama, all this heavy stuff, it's going this way. That's all it is. And so, and like, we're moving all the time in there. And that's why people say, when is this going to happen? Well, it's when we make our choices. And so, and what I was told when somebody, when I gave that diagram to in a talk, and they said, so at what point do these two really, you know, when they don't see each other? And they said, when there's no more in the middle. And there's no more in the middle. So it's like, see, at we're every day we're making our choices, which one feels better to us, which one we like, which one we want to continue with. And it, you know, it's just being, this is where we go back to being conscious of what we think and feel and believe, things like that. You know, be mindful of what you're thinking, be mindful of your choices. It doesn't mean, oh my gosh, everything hinges on this choice. Oh, which way am I going? Just feel it. Feel the choice. How does it feel? Does it come from your heart? Does it come from love? Do you feel the lightness? You know, then that will move you this way. If it's something that feels icky, you know, and you don't want that, then maybe don't, you know, choose differently. You know, so that's all it is. It's just be aware of what your every choice is yours. Yeah. Absolutely every choice is yours. And that's what I love about this time now, is we are really recognizing that we are responsible. We are the ones doing this. It's not being done to us. It's not, oh, we're gonna being selected or anything like that. We are the ones choosing where we want to go and what we want to do. It's us. That's free will.
Yeah.
This is us.
And it, you know, it is remarkable. And I totally agree with you with this being more of a vibration, a state of consciousness. And many other spiritual teachers in this time point to the same thing, it being a shift in human consciousness, a shift in our, because, you know, everything is energy. Of course, we were taught that by your mother, and we were taught that by quantum physics and Einstein and people throughout history, that everything is vibrating at a certain frequency. And so this is always pointed to this frequency being raised collectively, or the volunteers raising the collective consciousness of humanity, so that we can go into this new earth. So I mean, I agree. I think that's exactly what's happening. We're in the midst of it. We're in the middle of it. I think the culmination point was, as your mum pointed out, in 2012, and now we've seen so many changes. I think for the better. I know it's, we can easily get caught up in the negative, because sometimes things need to break down to break through to something. And absolutely, often we perceive that as, oh, we're going into a negative trajectory. But if you look holistically at it, you actually see we've come so far, the way we view each other, that, I mean, there's less harm done collectively than I think has ever been before. Right. So,
yeah, you'll have pockets of things. And that's just where, you know, I don't, people do things, you know, I think, but it's up to each one of us individually to determine how we want to react to something. That's what, you know, we have control. We only have control of a few things, and that's our thoughts and our reactions. And that's it. Everything else is happening, but our thoughts and our reactions, our beliefs, they are what determine what happens. And so it's like, because we attract, you know, we're attracting beings. And that's what's so cool, is we're really realizing that now. That's where we take responsibility. That's what I'm saying, with our thoughts. So if we're able to look at how we react to things and understand that that is what's determining where we go, what we do, you know, how we do things, it's like this planet, this plane, it has been known through eons that it loves to use fear as its, you know, it's just a mechanism. It's a fear mechanism. That's just what it is. It's laden with fear. So it's like the quicksand or the yucky muck that we walk through here on Earth. That's what we have to learn to recognize. And, you know, it's just recognizing fear for what it is and not getting sucked into it. It's really, I had an experience And it's been happening a lot since then. It's like just to recognize fear, because fear takes many faces. It has many disguises. And it's after a little while, you realize, oh my gosh, this is what it is, you know, but that's what it does. And it, you get sucked into the drama of it and all that stuff. And then it's like, oh my gosh, what was happening here? So I made a game out of the things that were happening. And I was like, okay, I'm going to figure out how to recognize fear sooner. And so each time something would happen, I would, it might, first it took me days to realize, oh my gosh, this is fear. You know, then once I recognize it as fear, then I can pull, I can change my reactions. I can shift my energy with it. And so then it got to where it was like hours, then minutes. And then it became like that. Your fear. You know, and that's what, just know fear is just something it's teaching us. It's something, it's an illusion. It's completely an illusion. So if things are using fear, just understand that's a mechanism that's being used to try and sway you to something, try and pull on your emotions, you know, get you to go a certain way, whatever, because it's worked. It's worked so long as a control mechanism.
For thousands of years, hasn't it? Well, even let's look at
millions, probably.
Yeah, from our from our beginning. You know, it's kind of like this discussion is going on. I'm seeing this a lot online at the moment. We tend to fear what we don't understand or that's new, anything that's a new concept. So we're seeing a lot in the media now around, you know, advancements in technology and artificial intelligence. And I've seen this wave of people jumping on the fear bandwagon around artificial intelligence. Oh my God, we're going to go into the Terminator and they're going to take over. And I heard a quote by Shirley MacLaine that she shared this recently. And she basically said, you know, artificial intelligence or technology is just an extension of our consciousness. And so if we're creating with a particular consciousness, that's just a tool. Artificial intelligence is not sentient. It won't become sentient. It's basically language models that have been designed by human beings to automate tasks. And right. We can get very caught up because it's new and we don't understand it.
Absolutely. Like you said, anything we don't understand, we tend to fear it. That's our first thing to go to. So if we understand that about ourselves, and that's what I'm saying, if you can recognize it sooner, oh, wait a minute, I'm going to fear here. How can I look at this differently? How can I reframe this so that I'm not seeing it this way? Because fear is an illusion. It's not real. I mean, that's just where we go. And, you know, we have all these things in this plane. Oh gosh, it just wreaks my mind of all these things to scare us. People love to be scared. A lot of people, I don't, but a lot of people love to be scared. I was surprised to find out the other day that horror, things based in horror, like movies and games, and are like number one sellers.
I was going to mention the horror movie. Well, there's a whole industry, isn't there? Just, or, you know, think about a theme park, right? I mean, people will pay to go into a theme park. Yeah. To be scared all day long, you know, they'll pay big money for it.
Yeah, exactly. So if we understand, you know, if we understand that about ourselves, it's like, you know, okay, if we like to be scared and we're doing all these things that scare us, then remember, we attract what we believe and we think about and things like that. These things are in our mind. You know, we watch these movies, it's in our minds. We have computers, our brains are computers, you know, and they're just taking in, and then they spit out based on what they've taken in. Mm. And we spit out by creating our world, our environment around us, okay? So you look at your environment. If it is scary to you, if you have things happening that are scary or there's a lot of fear entrenched and things like that, I would pay very close attention to what material I'm allowing in, what I'm watching, what I'm, you know, putting in. You got to watch what's going into that brain. You know, if you feed it fear, it's going to fill your life with
Well, let's look at something that's quite prevalent, okay? And I know you know all about this within our spiritual community, and it's the conspiracy, you know, rabbit holes. And we've all been there. We've all been down those. And look at those, you know, because you get a little bit of truth. They might take a concept, and then people build this whole narrative around it, and people write books about it, and there's plenty of YouTube videos and other videos where there's an element of truth in it, but then this narrative is built around all the what ifs, and really it brings me back to just how disempowering it is when you're out of your own power.
Absolutely, and that's what you want to look at. I mean, we have that power of discernment. That's a huge tool that we have been given to discern for ourselves what is truth for us, for each one of us. Now, the people that are doing that, if somebody is doing that, that might be their truth. It might very well be for them to go on that kind of a escapade. It's like, I must let you know. And I've had a lot of people, you need to be aware of these things. You've got to know these things. I'm like, no, I don't. Yeah. Because no, I know that I create my world. And if that's in fear, you know, I don't want that world that you're saying is going to happen here. And I know that we have many unlimited possible futures that can happen. And it's based on what we think. See, each one of us is creating our, like I said, we're creating our world. We're creating our futures. In essence, if there's 8 billion people on this planet, we can have 8 billion different futures that are happening here. 8 billion different timelines of what is happening on this planet. 8 billion. So it's like, well, this is what is going to happen. Maybe in your world because you so believe it, but not in my world because I am not taking stock in your belief. Really discern if it works for you. You have to feel it. See how it feels for you. If it's drenched in fear, recognize that and make your own choices to if that resonates with you. Is this the world I want? And this is where I get people like, oh, well, this is the way it is. This is the way it is. I'm like, but is that what you want? Oh, no, but this is how it is. I got to prepare. But see how, and I get it. I get where, you know, I get that understanding. I get that level of thinking. I totally get it. But I'm over here going, but I'm creating my world. So how about I don't?
Yeah.
Take stock in that, and I take stock in what I want to have. So see, there you totally can choose. And this is what I feel like is what we're really doing the most right now is shedding the light on the fact that we each and every one of us can choose our reality.
Yeah. It reminds me of a talk or a lecture that your mother gave once, and I think it was around that Y2K. Remember that? When the world was going to end and all these people were coming to your mom in fear, what's going to happen? Or even in 2012, they did the same thing. And she said, it's going to be fine. Nothing's going to happen.
Yeah. And they're always like, what did Nostradamus say? Is this the end? Blah, blah, blah. And oh, you know, they're freaking out. And she did so many shows at that point. And it's like, he saw beyond this. He saw, he's like, nothing's going to happen. He didn't say anything about that. So it's like, oh, fine.
She was kind of the voice of reason when this kind of, so it's not a new thing, is it? I mean, we've seen it throughout centuries, really, of this idea of domination and control and disempowerment. But, you know, we always have a choice. You know, I did a past life regression, a QHHT session last week. And, you know, a woman that was, you know, hundreds of years ago in a time when women didn't have a lot of power. And she was going very specifically into this past life. And in fact, even though that men were quite dominating in the time, there were certain women that found certain power and they were able to navigate that. So even though we look at history and think women didn't have a voice ever in those generations, we find exceptions. So I think that's really interesting when you dive into some of the past life regression work, you actually do see these individual stories throughout history. They're doing things differently because they find their individual power.
Absolutely. You know, and what we think about history is what we were taught. And that was whatever was the prevalent, you know, whoever wrote the books, that was what they wanted to have taught out there. So, you know, that's what I love about QHHT is you can go back and see the real stories, see what really happened, and get real.
Yeah. And real information from the source.
Real information. Exactly. Absolutely. And that's where mom was going to write a book on, she was saying, she kept joking about it. I think it was in her mind, but she's like, I'm going to write a book on history the way it really happened.
Yeah, exactly. Because we've got so many skewed versions of what, you know, history was supposed to have been. It sort of brings me into my next question around, you were mentioning Nostradamus before, and I know something that was mentioned in the Nostradamus books was this concept of the language was used similar to what was described in the New Testament, which is 1,000 years of peace. Mm-hmm. I think, you know, certainly this is my own interpretation, but I think that is pointing to this concept of the new earth. And I think Nostradamus did touch on it in the Nostradamus book series.
I agree. It's this calming down. I mean, it's so funny because those books, the last time I read them was when 9/11 was happening. Well, actually I did read them again later and I saw some other things, but it's like they shift and they move as history is happening. It's really interesting.
Yeah.
But yes, what you're saying, it's like it was happening. It was showing that this Christ, it was showing that, like I said, the time of, I'm trying to remember the person it said, but the peace person, you know, it was like,
the great genius, I think it was called.
The great genius. And so, whether that's a person or that's just a consciousness, you know, where we shift. Yeah. Cause you know, they've been talking for centuries about Christ coming, and then it's like, well, it's actually Christ conscious,
you know? A perfect example actually. And isn't it funny, because there's a great example of, you know, literalist Christians have believed for every generation since Christ that the second coming of Christ was going to be in that generation. He's coming soon. But you're exactly right. It points to a state of consciousness that we're in now, the second coming, this new Christed way of thinking, this new consciousness. It's synonymous exactly with all of your mother's work, because it ties in so well into this new consciousness, this new earth, this new 1,000 years of peace. The Nostradamus spoke about it as well. Truth is truth, hey? And you get it in different forms and different interpretations. But interesting, isn't it, that Christians for thousands of years believed that the second coming of Christ would be a literal thing. And then some people, even with the three waves of volunteers on the new earth, believed that it was going to be a literal thing, but maybe it was metaphoric, like the Bible was. It's just pointing to something energetically, a shift that's occurring.
Yeah, I mean, because, you know, really Christ and the other masters that were here at that point, you know, Buddha and Muhammad and Abraham and all that, they were all here to show the way. That was the name. That was of Jesus. That was the name of his, what he was created, was like, show you the way, because where it was the entrenchment, you know, God keep doing this this way and down this violent road and everything. It's like, no, you are responsible for your thoughts, your actions, your belief. I mean, it's the same stuff we're saying now. And it's just, this is what you can do. You can shift your life and you can be on this path. And that's why I feel like it's that whole structure, not individually, it's a consciousness that's shared. You know, we are all creating that. We are all knowing it. We're coming into that.
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. And, you know, I mean, it is true in a lot of senses. You know, we have left this old earth, this dark sort of trajectory that we were once on. I mean, we're all living through that. And I don't know about you, but I just sense things are lighter. And, you know, I have a lot of sessions where people leapfrog into future, what we would call future, even though all time is existing now. You talked about simultaneous time. Yeah. And every person that does that, they go into, I've done group future life regressions, it's always positive. It's always these great advances in medicine. It's great advancements in technology where we're able to travel at faster speeds with new technology. It's a cleaner planet. I get some wonderful things in QHHT session about our positive trajectory.
Right. Yeah, absolutely. And that's what we see overall. It's I think the biggest thing is knowing that this is coming in strong. It's like we create, our thoughts create. And if you want to continue with the fear concepts and anything you fear, you're creating it. So if you want things to be scary, if you want, like you were talking about some of these different advancements that are happening, but people are afraid of it, that is a possible future that you can create for yourself, is one that's full of fear and one where this stuff is really working against you. But there's also other options that you have to believe in and you can create. And that's where it's all working for you. These are tools. These are wonderful advancements to help you do many, many times more than what you ever thought you could do. They are tools. We create them. Let's go back on AI. We're AI.
Yeah.
Really.
Exactly. Well, that's it. And, it's the outward world. And I was taught this years ago by, I think it started with Louise Hay when she first said it, is just a projection of our state of consciousness. So we're like the projector. Life is a screen. We project the image, the consciousness, and whatever's on that projector will project onto the screen what's in the projector. People know that example because they've seen many films, they've watched that happen. And you can have many types of films, can't you, to use that analogy? Absolutely. You go watch a horror film, then if you've got horror in your consciousness, then it's going to play out in what you're focused on. But, if you're going to watch something else, you get to choose. This is the thing. We get to choose what we watch in life.
Yes, absolutely. We get to choose. That's free will.
Mm. And that's how powerful we are, because we are free will beings, and we can create anything we want in life, good, bad, or indifferent. We get to choose that on an individual level, don't we?
Absolutely. And that's, like you said, that's the power. That's why we are here. And that's what we're teaching each other, is that we are the ones doing this. We are the ones creating this. It's not being done willy-nilly. We are not victims. This is that. We are the ones doing each and every bit of it. And so as we understand that and take that responsibility, the life shifts. At first it's like, what the heck? I would not create something like that. There's actually a little anger there. It's like, I wouldn't do that. No, I would not do that. And then as you kind of keep accepting, it's like, not really. Would I really would do that? No. And then it keeps coming. And then as it goes over here, it's like, I did that. See, we're okay with accepting the good stuff that we create, but the bad stuff, something else did that. And I didn't do that. But see, but we've got to take it all. But if you can create the bad stuff, if you can accept that you created the bad stuff, look how powerful you are. If you can do that, you can create whatever you want.
Yeah. Well, that's it. That's a very empowering thing. If you've realized that you've attracted negative relationship after negative relationship, rather than getting down upon yourself, accept that you created it. And if you created it, you can create something different, because that's how powerful you are.
Absolutely. But you've got to accept that you did all of it. You have to accept that you did the bad stuff, that you did the stuff that's yucky, before you'll get it all. You have to accept it, and then it all works for you. Because if you don't accept that, then you'll go to this fear place. You'll go, I don't know what I'm creating. I don't know what might happen. What if? You have to know, I did this, so I can do this. It's super powerful, super empowering.
It brings me to think about what you know, religion had done for thousands of years was to create this literal adversary, the devil. Everyone know, particularly in Western culture, we know a lot of us grew up with this image of a devil with horns, and a lot of people still believe it to this day. But it was like, in a way, a manifestation of our collective consciousness, wasn't it? That we needed a adversary out there to put all of our blame on. It's almost like a big scapegoat, isn't it? Because we can blame the devil for our behavior, and we can blame the devil for this person's behavior, and we can justify everything.
Right. Well, as long as we can blame something else and it belongs to something else, then we are not in control. I didn't do that. You know, but see, but that takes our power away. Even giving the bad stuff to something else, that takes our power away. And this time is about taking the power back. That's why you have to take responsibility for your part in everything that's happening. No being did that to you. No being is responsible except for you. Each and every one of us is responsible for our own stuff.
Yeah, absolutely.
A hard pill. It can be a hard pill to swallow at first.
I think it's an incredibly hard pill for some people to swallow. And we've had this conversation before. You know, I mentioned to you, I think in our last chat, a lot of people say to me, look, I just can't accept that someone would create cancer in their body, or I can't accept that I would create illness, or I'd create a disaster. And it's kind of like, why did it get to the point where you needed something so dramatic because you weren't listening? And that goes back into your book, that the body is a great communicator. It is essentially a communicator. And if we're not getting it, the severity of an issue will get more dramatic until you eventually, hopefully, before it's too late, get that message.
Yeah, you'll get the message. It's just a message. It's simply a message, something to get your attention, to get you to pay attention to get the message. And that's it. Once you understand the message, it goes away. That's why it doesn't, you know, when you look at it from that perspective, it's like, it's not something horrible you're doing to yourself. You're not killing yourself or anything like that. It can go that far if you will not listen. But that just means that message has to get louder and louder and louder. And that's where it gets more severe, more severe, more severe, to get your attention. Just to give you the message.
I'll give you a perfect.
We do that. We are the ones doing it. It's nobody doing it to us. We're doing it.
Yeah, absolutely. Let me give you a perfect example of that. I had a QHHT session a couple of weeks ago. And the woman said to me, look, the main reason I made the appointment, because I was scared, that they found what looked like potentially a tumor or a lump in her brain. So, of course, she heard about QHHT, or she knew about it, and then she booked a session. Her higher consciousness came through at the time and said, no, she's going to be fine. It was just a way for us to get her to have the session.
Hello.
I got an email today saying, oh yeah, it's fine. My higher self is right.
Yeah, absolutely. See, it's just to get your attention. It's delivering a message. It's something like that. Perfect. It got her to get the session.
Yeah. You know, I've seen that quite a few times actually, where it's kind of like, okay, they work through the body to get someone to get the healing for the other things that they need.
Right.
And sometimes
your higher self knows what you need, what motivates you, how you need to be talked to, whatever, how you listen, what you need to get you to get attention, to get your attention. Yeah. So that's why it will use whatever mechanisms it needs to get the point across. It knows what you understand.
Yeah. Yeah. Absolutely. It's such a wonderful book, this. And anyone that hasn't got this book, I know you can get it from Ozark Publishing. You can get it on Amazon. You can get it on Audible now. I've got both the printed book and the audio book. It's probably your mother's most popular book. I've read it a number of times. there's so much in it. And it's so relatable on so many levels to people. They really get it. And it's like, I think we have this mechanism when we hear truth, we know it. You know, I think we get that inner ding or that confirmation, or as you like to say, the truth bumps when we hear something.
Yes, absolutely. I mean, you know it, and that's where it's acknowledging. A lot of times we don't want to admit that we actually are in tune to that part of ourselves, that knowing part. But really, if you'll just allow and acknowledge it, just acknowledging something, it's like, yeah, I knew that. I don't know how I know it. I know that, you know, and look, sometimes we'll get these truth bumps. If you ever get those, that's the, you know, I think we call them goosebumps, or in some countries they call them chicken flesh or whatever, different things. Yeah. But it's those little bumps that come up. And that means whatever you just heard or whatever you just said is true. That's a huge deal to be able to ascertain truth, but that's the beginning, just to, you know, and acknowledge it. Oh my gosh, that's true.
Just you know? As you're saying that, I'm getting them all over my body. It's just saying that right on the point.
Absolutely. And that's just it, you know, acknowledge it. And then it allows for more to happen, more information, because we are always receiving information. They are always communicating to us. When I say they, I mean our higher consciousness. This is our guidance team that we came in with. This is an agreement that we are not here alone. We are never alone. We always have this guidance team. But remember, they can't interfere, but they can help us. They can communicate to us. They can help guide us. And this is how they do it, is through our mechanisms that we have allowed. You know, it's like, talk to me, tell me what I need, you know, whenever I need guidance. But we have to ask too, though. See, this is where they're doing these things. If we're not aware and we're just willy-nilly going down paths that we did not intend to go down. And so sometimes we get to points, it's like, you need to be going this way now. And so that's where these messages start coming in different ways, is to get us on the path that we intended to go. See, it's nothing. It's like I said, it's nothing. It's done to us. This is an agreement. If I get off track, help me to stay the course, you know, remind me what I'm doing here. And then while we're here, I just want to know, everybody needs to know, you can ask at any time. If you're feeling lost, if you're feeling, I don't know what to do, any of those things, ask. If you feel like you need assistance, ask. They are always ready to help, but they cannot jump in and do anything unless we ask.
Yeah, that's a great point, actually. You're right, because of that free will, they just cannot interfere. But the moment, I remember your mama said that, the moment that you put that call out or you ask for help, they'd love to help you. Yeah. I mean, they're right in there. And
I'm
you're including me. I'm here, I'm waiting. And we give them the permission to act in our life. And I try to do this really consciously. I'm sure you do it all the time. I just try, wherever there's an opportunity for me to ask, it might be a parking place or some kind of a situation like that. I'm just conscious to put it out there. And you know what? Most of the time, remarkably so, there's the parking place, the green light, whatever it is, the favorite, the situation that goes in my favor, because I train myself to ask, and then I give a sense of gratitude. I thank
them. I was just gonna say, then you say thank you, then you're grateful, you do something, and see, and that just brings more in. It opens up funnel, I guess. I don't know. It opens up the energetic attraction of more.
Yeah, absolutely. And you know, I learned as well, you know, this concept where, you know, there's favorites or people are more, you know, this kind of idea that some people are lucky and some people aren't. You know what I've really found is I don't think any of that is true. I think we very much create the good, the bad, the indifferent in our life. And when we live consciously with purpose, on purpose, life becomes very different.
Absolutely. Completely, 100%, 1000% agree with you. Absolutely. Something else that came in when you said something about special, there's a tendency, and this is what I always find, it's like the waves, it's like, oh, I'm one of the waves. And that's wonderful if you identify with that, but it doesn't mean that you're more special. You're, yeah. You know, it's you came here to help everyone. We're all working. And what I'm seeing now is that because of that energy coming in, that maybe those that were not a volunteer, see their consciousness, their vibrations are raising. So it's a little hard to tell sometimes because we all have these abilities coming in. Remember, all the DNA is all being connected. It's all doing that. It's we had beings that wanted to come help to make that happen. So this, I guess I'm just trying to, I just see it a lot. It's like, well, I'm special because, you know, it's like, we're all special. Yeah. We all chose to go through this. We're all here. We're all working together.
I'm really glad you explained that and mentioned that because, you know, we can get, I've even seen it with the concept of volunteers or people that are doing work that, you know, in the spiritual community. And I love this that your mom said, she basically said, you know, some of you could walk through a crowded mall, and just by you walking through, you are changing and affecting the vibration of those that are coming into contact with you. And for those that maybe don't have an outward, you know, they're not doing conversations like this, or they're not working as a QHHT practitioner, never underestimate your ability and the effect that you're having on your environment, even if it's not conscious to those around you.
Absolutely. Yeah, or conscious to you.
Yeah.
You know, well, that's, you're just doing it. You know, by being you. And a lot of times, especially the second wave, they're like, what should I be doing? I want to do something. And it's like, yeah, when they always say, you just have to be, and like, but I want to do something. You know, and what they have said is like, do what makes you happy. That, what better way to put your energy out there? If you're doing drudgery work, your energy is going to be very dampened. It's going to be hard for you to be, you know, vibrating at this rate that you come in naturally to do. If you are doing what you love, it doesn't matter what it is, but doing what you love, you will be beaming out that beautiful, blissful energy. That's you doing what you are here to do.
Yeah. And that might be, you know, I see it a lot of time with artists. I, for some reason, get a lot of artists come to me, and by them creating, I always say, like, your creation process is synonymous with your spiritual practice. You're creating, you're bringing energy into the world through artwork. And I do it a lot through the work that I do and reels that I create and stuff. You know, there's incredible lot of artwork that goes into it because everything is energy, everything is vibration.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
And we all have something to give. You know, there's not one person that doesn't have, you know, it might be different from you to me or from me to the next person, but we all have a unique quality, an individual vibration, something to contribute.
Yeah, absolutely. We are all here for a reason and we all have something unique. And that's why I say it's like this big puzzle. We are all a piece in the puzzle. And if any one of us was gone, it wouldn't be a complete puzzle. We are all necessary to make this the big, beautiful puzzle.
Yeah. And, you know, I know a lot of people get caught up in this comparison game, and we're kind of almost conditioned to be pitted against each other to compete. No one, you know, I remember hearing this years ago, no one can be you, no one can be me. We're an individual expression of consciousness. It's such a shame when people want to, you know, be like an imposter. It's like imposter syndrome where they try to be something that they're not. The world misses out in that process of your individual expression of consciousness.
Absolutely true. Yeah. You are here for a reason. You are uniquely you. Nobody else can be you, you know? So why are you trying to be somebody else? It's like only you can give this earth, this plane, this experience that we're having. Only you can give it what you are giving.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's a powerful thing.
Specifically, yeah, exactly. You came in specifically for a reason. So be it. And that's what I was saying. I kept getting this message years ago. Someone asked me if Dolores were to deliver a message right now, and this was right after her passing, and what came in was, be here. Be here. So many of you just keep wanting to jump off the planet, leave and everything. And it's like, you'll leave when you're done, but be here now. And you know, you came here for a reason. So be here and do it. Then when you're done, you'll leave. You know, when you're finished, I promise you, you will leave, because you don't stay once you're done, once you've completed what you came here for. It just, that's how it works.
Yeah, absolutely. And you know what I so love about, you know, and I was watching that Gaia interview that you did, and those that are here on the YouTube, I encourage you to watch that interview with Julia. It's a wonderful interview where you first, I think it was the first interview that you did after, or one of the first anyway, after your mother transitioned.
I'll admit, I was scared to death. Yeah. I was so scared.
Well, you did great, by the way. It was very moving. It moved me. And I think,
go ahead.
Well, sorry, I was going to say, I think a part of what you were sharing is you were grappling with this surprise, if you like, of that she passed before her time. But then when you came to realize what had happened, and I think it's become more evident as the years have gone on, that she could do so much more. From the other side than she could ever physically do while she was incarnated here, right?
Absolutely. Yes. Yeah, that's what came in. As she was passing, I heard her say that, you know, as she was leaving the body. And that's evident because, oh my gosh, I hear stories. I get people telling me all the time how she's helping them. She's everywhere. Helping people with their sessions, with their, you know, understanding, or leading people in to have sessions or be a practitioner or things like that. It's like, yeah, she's everywhere.
Yeah, she really is. And I'm getting the truth bumps again. I feel so incredibly guided by her and inspired by her. And it was interesting. I was having a QHHT session a few weeks ago, and I was just counting the person out. So I was just counting the person out, and she said, "Stop, I've got a message for you." And lo and behold, it was from Dolores. And, you know, she said one thing that particularly moved me. She said a number of things, but one thing that particularly moved me, she said that, you know, you're so much younger than I was when you're starting out. And this will apply to everyone listening to this, that, and you've got so much energy and life to do. And you know what really touched me? She said, "And I'm living through all of you and loving it." She said, "I love this." And there was this real excitement. And this, she was an incredible somnambulist, this client that came through. There's some great information she shared. So it was a remarkable session. But I really loved that she lives through us all of her practitioners. I know she does through your life and your work now, carrying on her legacy. I just think that was a beautiful a way of articulating it.
Absolutely. You know, and that also shows what happens to us when we pass. So we don't stay the singular being that is on this. We shift into we know we're multidimensional already, or at least, you know, I know that now. If you don't know it, just open your mind to that possibility. We are multidimensional. And then once you enter that phase, it's like it expands you to that multidimensionality to be omnipresent at the same time. You know, some people are like, "Well, how can they do that and help me and be here?" And it's like there are no limits. See, remember, there's no time and there are no limits once you cross that, that layer that we have, you know, that brings us into here.
Yeah. I don't know if it was you that shared this with me. Someone did a while back. They said that it was either you or someone else, that all great masters, and I think your mother falls into that category, continue their work after they've transitioned. So that it doesn't stop there. They energetically are connected to their work and it continues on. It might have been Blair. If it wasn't you, it was, I think, Blair that shared with me.
Yeah, I don't remember saying that, but it makes total sense we don't stop when we pass. We don't stop. We are always moving and progressing. This is one area that we're learning so much. And then why would we stop? Yeah. You know, we go and we continue on our learning and on our whatever we're doing. We just keep going. So it's like it could be that whatever we're doing has reached the limitation of the human body. And so that's where it needs to move on and go into that other realm to do the next phase of it. And that's I think where she was. I mean, Blair, talking about Blair, when my mother was kind of, it was in this point of what was going on. She was sleeping a lot, you know, and after, you know, when she was in the hospital. And I talked to Blair and he said, well, I've seen, she's meeting with her counsel and she's trying to decide what to do. She's trying to decide, do I stay, do I go, what do I want to do? And that makes sense. You know, I told her that because she's like, what do you think is going on? And I told her what he said. And she goes, oh, that makes sense. You know, so it's like, you know, and that's where she was trying to decide. And then when she said, I can do so much more on the other side, that was her decision.
Yeah. And it you know what, it makes total sense. I think we very obviously saw this huge increase of people receiving the information so much more than she could have ever physically done. I mean, she was getting exhausted in the end, all that international travel. I was saying this to someone the other day. It's remarkable. She was writing at night. She was lecturing during the day. She was traveling. She was a mother. She was a grandmother. I mean, I don't know how she did it. I don't know how she did it either.
At the time, I was like, well, you've got assistance. You know, I was there working with her and everything. And so I was helping her with that load and stuff to some degree. But now that I have, you know, I'm over here trying to do these things, I'm like, and I'm not doing everything that she was doing. I'm like, I do not know how she did it. Absolutely do
remarkable.
Not know.
Remarkable.
Yeah, it took energy that, and we always joked and said she was like the Energizer bunny, you know, whatever the battery, just constantly going. And yeah, she just had an energy supply.
Yeah, incredible. I mean, and she worked, not everyone will know this, but she literally worked right till the end. She wasn't sick when she passed. It was sudden. How old was she when she passed?
83.
This is incredible in itself. 83. Most people, are, you know, they retire at 70, but a lot of people retire at 70.
Earlier.
And she was very, very active and I'm sure busy right to the end. A lot of people ask, and we touched on it earlier, about life purpose. And I kind of want to mention this. You know, a lot of people might be watching this and they're thinking, you know, I want to do something. I want to be a part of something, but I don't know what it is. And I think this is going to speak to a number of people listening now. If this resonates to become one of Dolores's practitioners, a QHHT practitioner, can you share if someone is feeling like this resonates with me, Dolores resonates with me, how does someone go about that?
Absolutely. And that's what I call, that's how exactly how I present it, is this, if it resonates with you.
Yeah.
I call it the passion factor. If you have that desire to help people, but you're not sure what you can do, what relates to that, how you can do it, then this could very well be it. And that's where I invite you to go to our website, qhhtofficial.com, and read, you know, what we're about, how it looks, all these things, and how the course works, the information, how you will work with people, and see if it resonates with you. Because this is a beautiful, beautiful way of helping people to get their answers to their questions, to understand who they really are. I mean, to me, what else is better than that?
Absolutely.
What a wonderful way to help people. And that's why we're here. We're here to help each other remember. So this just ticks all the boxes to me. So, but that's one way. And I think you have a link for people to be able to.
Yeah, I can share that as well on the screen. And you know what I love about it is I've heard so many beautiful stories about, you know, single moms that, you know, basically didn't have qualifications, and they've been passionate, they've empathic people, right. And they've picked this up and they've made, you know, a career out of it and done very, very well. I love hearing those stories. I know there's thousands and thousands of practitioners, and we need new practitioners all the time, everyone. Like, there's never going to be enough practitioners, because this really is the healing of the future. Your mother said that. And, you know, even in my city, for example, we've got 20 or so, it's a city of nearly 6 million people. We've only got 20 or so practitioners. Well, we need more practitioners in this area.
No way that the 20 of you can see everybody that needs help. And that's when mom was given the message from her higher self through a client, was told, you need to start teaching this because you cannot see everybody in this world that needs to have this sessions. You know, there's no way. So you need to get more people out there. And that's what we're
absolutely
doing. We're getting more people.
Because
it is the way of the future. It is the medicine. One practitioner had this come up in their session, and there was somebody in a futuristic time. And they said, they were looking back at this time. They said, this is when everything shifted. This is when this was created. And they saw this technique as this like the beginning, the wave of the new medicine, the new whatever way of healing ourselves, the way of, you know, new understanding about who we are.
Yeah. And I think a great companion too, and it's certainly changed my life. I tell this to people all the time. I use it every day. I used it yesterday in my QHHT session, your book, Soul Speak. And what's so wonderful, and I love how you've done this, along with the book, which you can get on Amazon and Ozark Publishing and Audible as well. Audible, there's a great audio recording of the book. You've actually got it as a program, don't you? An online program. And I'm going to link that below on the screen for people to be able to see the web address for that. Tell us a little bit about the program and how, after reading the book, that helps practitioners, but not just practitioners, people that want to learn how to heal and understand their bodies.
Yeah, it can help you on a personal level to heal yourself, to understand what the messages are that you're creating for yourself to learn from. Remember, we said just to get your attention, get a message. And once you understand how it speaks and how it communicates, you can get that message. Then the ache, pain, illness, whatever it is, can go away. And it will go away because you are now acting out what it was wanting, what you yourself was wanting to teach yourself or tell yourself. So it starts there. Now, if you want to help other people, it's teaching you how to do that, how to now be a practitioner to help guide others to understanding their messages. And that's where it's a certification course to certify you to be able to practice with other people.
Too.
And it expands on the book. So it's not just exactly, I mean, it follows the same outline as the book, but it expands. We have live testimonials, live, this is what I found, you know, from practitioners that are like, this is how this is working. This is what I've seen, you know, so it brings the book to life.